Hey, everybody. Ham Radio Now, episode 180. Clarifying the amateur Bell 202 modem with Kenneth Finnegan, W6KWF. It's from the Tapper Digital Communications Conference 2014 version back in Austin, Texas. And I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. And, you know, Kenneth reminds me a little bit of me. There's Kenneth and the editor waiting for his program to be fully baked. He reminds me a little bit of me, not because he's finishing up a master's degree at age 25 and understands technology far better than I could ever hope to, you know, being an appliance operator and all. Me, not him. But several times during this talk, he's going to express frustration that he wanted to learn something and went looking for information and resources and couldn't find anything, at least not anything useful. And that happens to me all the time. But Kenneth doesn't give up. He turned some of that frustration into his master's thesis on packet radio and APRS. Cool. Get a master's degree in your hobby. You know, the P in Tapper stands for packet, or at least it used to until they went all KFC on us. Well, in this talk, we're going to get a chunk of Kenneth's thesis. And that's hard to say. Kenneth's thesis. Try that a few times. Say it fast. We're going to get a chunk of that, where he dug into the software guts of the Bell 202 modem. That is the heart of good old packet radio. And that's all coming up after I have thanked the hams who supported my Kickstarter that funded getting me out to Austin to record all the sessions, and then getting me back home to produce them here in the Ham Radio Now studios. 108 hams contributed between $10 and $150 each as individuals, and the rest came from what I will loosely refer to as our corporate underwriters. And it starts with these guys.
Adam Curry, John C. Dvorak.
It's Sunday, September 7th, 2014. Time for your Gitmo Nation Media Assassination, episode 650.
This is No Agenda.
Adam Curry is KF5SLN. John C. Dvorak is KJ6LNG. This is not another one of those ham radio podcasts. No, these guys take on politics, the media, entertainment, anything they want. Sometimes they do say something nice about ham radio. Everybody else is pretty much trashed. You know, there's a lot of hams in their audience. They even have a Google Plus community, and Adam is active in that Google Plus group. Just Google No Agenda Hams, and, well, there it is, number 3 on the list. You don't need a Google account to see it. You do need one if you want to participate. Adam and John are live on the internet every Sunday and Thursday at noagendashow.com, or you can download the show as soon as Adam gets it uploaded, and he works quick, gets it uploaded pretty quick. It's at their website, and using most podcast apps, so just go to noagendashow.com. We are also brought to you by Tapper. Tapper sponsors the DCC. If you're interested in anything digital in amateur radio, hardware, software, voice, data, television, you'll be right at home in Tapper. And if you're getting a lot out of the DCC videos and you're not already a Tapper member, please consider joining them. Stop by their website, TAPR. Remember, the P stands for packet, TAPR.org, and check them out. We're also brought to you by several hams who encourage you to look at this place, hackersforcharity.org. Now, you guys know that the word hacker is often used to describe bad guys with computers. Well, these hackers are like you. They're the good guys, people who love to dig into their computers and software and make them do cool things. It may be a little bit unorthodox, but not necessarily evil. Hackers for Charity was founded by Johnny Long. You might have heard of him. He figured out that he and you could use your hacking skills to help out people around the world who really need you but can't begin to afford you. So maybe you can help. Check them out at hackersforcharity.org. We're also brought to you by the Amateur Radio Engineering Task Force at aretf.org. You are able to watch this video or listen to the audio on a wide variety of devices because there are standards. This is not news, especially for this audience. Also not news is that in amateur radio, especially in the digital and networking side of things, standards can be a little bit hard to come by. Just ask Kenneth, the guy presenting this program. So Brian, K7UDR, and another Kenny, a KU7M, launched AREtf. It's patterned after the IETF, the Internet Engineering Task Force. Their guiding principle is that you can't tell people what to do, especially hams. You have to form a consensus, and then maybe then most people will adopt a standard formed from that general agreement. Looking over here at their website, aretf.org, I'm not seeing a lot of progress. This is not the part that they paid me to say. I haven't seen a lot of progress from Brian or Kenny lately. You know, I know they're busy getting their product launched. They got a good reaction to AREtf at the DCC, but you know, maybe now is time for you to drop them a line and give them some encouragement to keep this thing going. Maybe it's time I ask them to come on Ham Radio Now and talk about it. Could be too. Anyway, if this interests you, stop by AREtf and follow the blog so you can keep up to date. We are also brought to you by an enthusiastic supporter of Ham Radio Now and Tapper, who wishes to remain anonymous. This ham is a regular attendee of the DCC for over 30 years. He's very enthusiastic about what the DCC and Ham Radio Now are doing together. And if you didn't get in on the Kickstarter and you want to support Ham Radio Now, we could use it, and you can. Stop by our website, hamradionow.tv. You'll find our mascot, Arvin, who's sitting back there over my shoulder. Click on him. He'll take you to our contribution page, and you can use PayPal or a credit card. And my thanks to everybody who contributes to Ham Radio Now and to the Kickstarter. And now, back to Austin, Tapper President Steve Bible, N7HPR, will introduce Kenneth.
I'd like to introduce next up Kenneth Finnegan, W6KWF, and you also did this work with Bridget Benson, PhD. So we're going to listen to his talk about clarifying the amateur Bell 202 modem, and this will be quite interesting. Take it away, Kenneth.
All right. Hello, guys. My name is Kenneth Finnegan, W6KWF. You can find me online at blog.thelifeofkenneth.com if you end up being at all interested about my life. And today I haven't heard that joke before. And today I'm going to be talking to you about Bell 202. I think I'm 25 years old. I'm just finishing up my master's thesis in APRS. And so what I'm going to be presenting to you today is essentially one of the six major chapters out of my thesis looking at the undefined behaviors in the complete APRS network stack, right? So I'm glad that Bob's kind of not here today because I'm going to take all sorts of pot shots at him for his style of not documenting. I think the fact that I'm 25 puts me in the unique position of being both the youngest person here and being the only person who is documenting, who is talking about a technology that existed before he was born. Right? So Bell 202 is the classic 1200 baud modem originally developed by AT&T and specified in document in AT&T publication number 41212. I am painfully aware of that number because I've never actually managed to find that document. So if any of you have access to that publication, I've never actually seen the original specification for Bell 202. It's a 1200 baud system that we use in several amateur radio packet networks since we got authorization from the FCC in 1981 to do packet radio, and these modems were available on the secondhand market at the time. It's also used in a few other systems such as caller ID. Bridget Benson is my thesis advisor, and she was gracious enough to sponsor me coming here, which is why I was able to afford flying out here. She is a professor at California Polytechnic, where I'm getting my master's degree, and she got pretty much every permutation of degrees involving computers, electrical, science, and engineering from Cal Poly, Santa Barbara, and San Diego. So why do we still care about Bell 202? Right? So Bell 202 is easily about 30 years old for what we've been using it for. But it's still used in some of our systems, right? APRS still uses it, WinLink still uses it. And it's kind of never died, right? So it's a very attractive modulation scheme because it's very accessible, right? Any of us can go buy a TNC and build the interface cables and take any VHF or UHF handheld radio, mobile rig, et cetera, and interface it, and then we can have a packet station on VHF. It's relatively easy to build modems for. I think the testament that we've seen several modems come out in the last few years from people that have no DSP experience is a testament to the fact that it's a fairly accessible modulation scheme, right? And so people like Scott Miller, who self-claims himself to not be a DSP guy, has managed to make software modems for it. And, you know, we love the legacy systems that we never let die, so it's still sticking around. Why am I personally talking about it? Again, like I said, this is one single part of my thesis, and I'm looking at the complete stack, right? So this is your typical network stack, where on the bottom we've got Bell 202, HDLC, and VHF. And then on top of this, we typically layer AX25, APRS, and then like APRS messaging for when we want layer 4 transport. I would gladly be corrected right now. Where the heck is the specification for what we call Bell 202? Who here has implemented any sort of hardware for Bell 202 or AX25? Did any of you actually successfully do it without reverse engineering some other system first? Right? So that's about half of you. Really what my thesis came down to was I started looking at, hey, I want to build a Bell 202 modem, and I went to go read the spec for it, and I couldn't find anything. So then I started talking to people, like, well, you know, Scott, how did you build the open trackers off of this spec? He said, oh, no, I just bought a TNC2 on eBay and reverse engineered it. I think it's a little silly that we're spending so much of our energy and time reverse engineering each other's systems in this room so that we can talk to them. And so the Amateur Radio Engineering Task Force is exactly what I was hoping to see, because we really need to start writing more specific documentation for this stuff, right? And so what you see in the proceedings on page 15 is kind of the beginnings of what I would hope would be a single definitive source for when you want to build a modem, this is the one document you read, and then you can build a modem, right? What I wrote isn't anywhere near sufficient for that, but we need those sorts of documents, because otherwise, we start seeing all this sort of weird broken behavior that you're seeing in APRS after 30 years of us reverse engineering stuff that reverse engineered other stuff. What I found particularly confusing was the fact that we all call Bell 202 what really isn't Bell 202. What we call Bell 202 is Bell 202 layered underneath high-level data link control and above VHF FM. Right, so AT&T designed Bell 202 as the modulation scheme used on telephone lines. But what we did was we put all of the HDLC framing on top of it, which is where all of the non-return to zero inverted encoding comes from, and where the frame checksum comes from, and causes all this stuff that suddenly ones are no longer marks and zeros are no longer spaces, but it's the transitions and stuff. And so I'm proposing the new name of amateur Bell 202, amateur Bell 202, to be what we refer to when you're talking about this complete conglomeration of Bell 202 modulation of HDLC data payloads over VHF FM. All right, so for example, this right here is just the letter A encoded in amateur Bell 202. And so it's least significant bit first, and then you can kind of see that on this first bit period and the second bit period here, it's a lower frequency than the third bit, and so the fact that it doesn't change on this transition right here means that it's a one, and then the fact that it changes here is a zero, right? And so I actually, as part of my thesis to try and figure out the checksum algorithm, I kid you not, I recorded a complete packet, printed it out on 10 sheets of paper, and sat there with a pen hand decoding this stuff, because I got myself so confused, because I managed to find 4 different results online for the checksum algorithm that we use. I found 4 different pieces of sample code that all produced different results, and I couldn't tell which one of them was right. So I finally had to just take a working tracker, printed out 10 pages of the audio, I loaded it up in Audacity and MATLAB, and then sat there with a red pen for 2 hours, decoded all the bits, and then did longhand division. This took 3 pages of scratch paper, longhand division to actually figure it out. And so actually figured out what the heck we do, So ISO 13239 is one of the newer revisions of what was several documents, which is X25, which AX25 is based on, which supposedly, which kind of alludes to defining the layer two physical layer, although it kind of doesn't, kind of the layer one modulation, which it kind of doesn't. But this is the first sentence. This is the first sentence out of section 4.2.5.2. This whole thing is one sentence, and I think this is a perfect example of why in the AX25 spec they added Appendix C and invented their own markup language for the actual AX25 spec, because ISO has this tendency of just abusing the heck out of English. I think I've pulled more hair out trying to parse their ideas of what a clear sentence is for these specs than I have for anything else in this thesis, right? So you'll notice that what we, this one sentence, the first thing you do is this part, then you move down here and append, which they don't do, they only say and, but what we're supposed to do is append this operation, and then you need to take the ones complement of it. Right, so that it's all sorts of abuse that if this had just been a bolded list of things that you need to do in order, it would have been a lot nicer. So as one of my contributions today, I would like to present this beautiful piece of pseudocode that isn't the most efficient implementation of the checksum algorithm we use, but is, I think, a little bit clearer. This shows you exactly how to, given a array of bytes, calculate the checksum for amateur Bell 202 in the end. Something important to notice about this is that this algorithm that I'm showing here calculates the checksum in reverse bit order, right? This is because every octet that we transmit on amateur Bell 202 is done least significant bit first, right? So on the first octet, you transmit the least significant bit all the way up to the seventh bit. Then on the second octet, you do the least significant bit up to the most significant bit. Except for on the frame checksum, which is transmitted 15th bit first in descending order. Apparently, whoever implemented this first didn't feel the need to write two completely separate modulating functions, and so they decided, hey, let's just calculate the checksum in reverse bit order so that when we transmit it least significant bit first instead of most significant bit first, it'll end up in the right order. Right? Reasonable thing, but no one ever really clearly said that, so I got very, very confused. Right? And so what you do once you've run this algorithm is you transmit the lower octet, which is bits 8 through 15, least significant bit first, because that least significant bit is bit 15, transmit that first, and then transmit the higher octet, which is bits 0 through 7. And if you're confused right now, welcome to the pain that has been the last 6 months for me. So I, in addition to this pseudocode here in Appendix A of my paper, I show a skeleton C program with a test suite. I show a simple APRS packet and tell you what the result should be so that if you write your own code, you can actually test it against something. We got a question over there, right? I haven't been able to find any test. I wasn't able to find anything to test it on. That's not true. I found several things to test it on, several of which were wrong. I think 2/3 of the sample code I found online didn't actually produce the correct results.
You're exactly right. I'm completely confused.
Good.
So, least significant bit is bit 15?
So, since I'm calculating the 16-bit number in reverse bit order,
right.
The least significant bit of the number returned here is the 15th bit of the checksum.
Okay, but in just looking at the actual packet that you're sending, bit 0 is the 0-1 bit, and bit 15 is the whatever 65,000 bit.
So when we actually transmit this,
right?
The first bit to come out of the modem is the highest bit out of the checksum. Since I'm calculating the checksum in reverse order, it's going to be the lowest bit that returns from this function.
Okay.
Right? And I kind of make that, and that's why I put the C skeleton code, because this is really confusing. Right? So if you're in any environment that is even remotely close to C, the easiest way to do it is to just take my skeleton code and copy it in there, right? I don't think I made the licensing entirely clear on that code, but as far as I'm concerned, as long as you throw some thank yous in my direction, I wouldn't be too restrictive with that. Phil Karn, I guess, isn't here today, which is kind of too bad, because I was going to give him a lot of major props. So as part of this thesis, I've been looking at KISS, right? The Keep It Simple, Stupid, which is an utterly meaningless title for what is our link between our modems and our computers, which Phil and I'm blanking on the second guy's name. The two of them decided to have it transport a part of the AX25 packet down here that is documented nowhere. Right? As far as I can tell, this is the first time that AX25 has been shown in a complete form that does not include the frame checksum. Because the frame checksum is not transported in the KISS link because it's not part of the layer 2 AX25 protocol. The frame checksum up here is actually part of what is actually a part of the layer 1 amateur bell 202, which includes the start flag, the payload, which is usually AX25, the frame checksum, and then the end flag. All right? My paper also notes that a lot of people, there's been a lot of controversy lately, and I don't think I've actually gotten three people to agree with each other as far as the zero bits. Right? So since amateur bell 202 uses NRZI, which is non-return to zero inverted, when you send a long string of zeros, it results in a continuous set of transitions between the high and the low tones, 1200 hertz, 2200 hertz. Scott Miller did some testing with original phase lock loop hardware modems, and apparently if the modems have drifted out from idling at the center carrier of 1700 hertz, they tend to not lock well on the 7E, and they tend to clock lock much better on a string of zeros, and he sees significantly improved throughput. Unfortunately, apparently some of the newer modems don't do carrier sense on zero bytes, but look for the 7E to indicate the beginning of flags, and it breaks stuff. So I haven't found, I'm still gonna show this not in a definitive we should do this way, but the zero octet seems like a better way to do the preamble on the 7E than the 7E, because the 7E actually has the lowest clocking power of any possible octet in the entire amateur bell 202. And so why we're using it as our preamble for an asynchronous protocol is very unfortunate, right? And so what a lot of modems are doing now is we are sending a long string of zeros, then we send a couple 7E flags, then we send the payload, frame checksum, 7E flag, and then either drop the carrier or do a second packet. AX25 stuff down here, I talk about that a little bit as far as APRS, but I won't bore you too much on that. Emphasis and de-emphasis, as far as I can tell, this is a non-solvable problem. It can't be done. So the problem is what's called twist, where the audio passband from the transmitter, you know, from the modem interface at the transmitter to the modem interface at the receiver is not perfectly flat. The magnitude of the 1200 hertz tones and the magnitude of the 2200 hertz tones are almost never the same, right? Most people blame this on what's called pre-emphasis and de-emphasis, because in voice communications, they went, hey, if we put a 6 dB per octave pre-emphasis so that higher tones see wider modulation, we can get a better signal-to-noise ratio on the receiver. The problem is, well, first of all, the pre-emphasis and de-emphasis filters are not at all consistent between radios. Some of them are flat up to 1,000 hertz and then start rolling up. Some of them are flat up to 2 kilohertz and then start rolling up, but that's the end of the channel passband pretty soon, so it tends to not do anything. A lot of people do single pole, just a straight integrator, which is unfortunate. And so it's not unusual to see any permutation of a transmitter using emphasis or not using emphasis, and then the receiver using de-emphasis or not using de-emphasis. This isn't all entirely pre-emphasis and de-emphasis fault. I've seen several impedance mismatches that are not this that cause, so like the, I had some particular issues with the FT1500 this year. It has a high pass filter on the microphone. No, what is it, a low pass filter? It had some capacitors on the microphone inputs that the data port still went through, which caused impedance mismatches with the open tracker, plus the impedance mismatches between the GM300 you're using to receive it and the sound card, and we ended up with about a 7 dB difference in magnitude between the 1200 hertz and the 2200 hertz tones, right? Supposedly, there's some Bell 202 spec somewhere that says that the two tones have to be within 2 dB of each other, but I've never seen this spec. And so I'm proposing that on the actual VHF links, we try and shoot for both tones, having both symbols having an equal deviation of 3.5 kilohertz, or about 70%. I've gotten almost no one to agree with this except for Scott Miller. Everyone else says, of course we should be using pre-emphasis. You know, so the 2200 hertz tone is this, and then the 1200 hertz tone is a little bit less than that. Well, fine, so we get both of them as close to this as you can, but it's really, it's an unsolvable issue. There is way too many radios out there and way too many systems that have done this incorrectly somehow, and it's become exceedingly clear that as far as Bell 202 goes, the only way that we're ever gonna do any maintenance or any fixing on any of these systems is we need to wait for the radio's PA to blow out in the digipeater. That is the only way that we're ever gonna change anything is we need to go around with a giant Tesla coil and zap their front ends to force them to actually rebuild it, which I do not recommend. That would not encourage the advance the art. Furthermore, saying 3.5 kilohertz deviation is not a particularly useful metric. How many people here have a quantitative way to measure VHF deviation out of their radios? Yeah, a few, and we're at the DCC, so it's probably a little bit of a biased set. So this is never gonna get fixed. So what I'm proposing is that we need to put a lot more effort now into building modems that are more tolerant of this twist problem, and so that when we inevitably get it wrong, we can deal with it. And so I was trying to come up with, well, what's a good number for our modem should tolerate X number of dB of twist. And so I was searching through my personal library and I happened upon this. This is a beautiful diagram of the allowable distortion in an AT&T basic 3002 telephone trunk line channel. And I figured, well, since Bell 202 came from the telephone systems, why don't we pull our tolerance specs from the telephone system as well? And so what they specify Bell 202 basic 3002 telephone channels as, given a test tone at 1,004 hertz, and if anyone knows where that tone comes from, I would love to hear why it's 1,004.
So it doesn't beat note with the sampling frequency.
Perfect. So it's 1,004 so that it doesn't beat note with the sampling frequency. They specify that relative to that point, you're allowed this level of distortion at every other tone. Luckily, we're only concerned with 1200 hertz and 2200 hertz, and so really, we can simplify this down to the fact that between this point and this point, or between this point and this point, our modems just need to tolerate about 10 dB of twist, which is a lot. That's a lot of twist, right? We're talking signals that are significantly lower than each other by almost an order of magnitude. And I've seen channels with that level of twist before. this stuff is seriously broken, right? And so the fact that like the AGWPE sound modem rolls over and dies as soon as you have any positive twist or negative twist, well, any twist where the higher tone is lower in magnitude, it rolls over and dies. We had a problem this year at a large event where we were building a APERS network. We were seeing 12% throughput on one of our point-to-point links, right? This isn't even from the trackers. This is from a digipeter back to a receiver. And we were seeing 12% throughput because of this emphasis problem, right? So next year, we're not going to be using AGWPE. We're looking at actually having four TNC modems sitting there because the old phase lock loop hardware modems and the open trackers with their zero crossing algorithms are surprisingly tolerant of this twist that the new digital signal processing algorithms are not, right? And so I haven't done it yet. I don't think I'm gonna have enough time because my thesis has been spiraling out of control as far as scope, but I would love it if someone were to build a more quantitative test suite than the LMF Stephen Smith CD, as far as generate every, you know, so start with zero twist and then start work, you know, build test tones that go farther and farther out here so that we can get quantitative metrics as far as how tolerant is any one specific modem to this kind of twist. And so then we can then start working on algorithms. Like Savon Toledo 2 years ago was actually the original inspiration for this whole thesis when I read his QEX paper on how he added a low-pass filter to the Linux sound modem and got a significant improvement. I want us to keep playing with that until we can start meeting these sorts of tolerances because we really need to meet this to get kind of the throughput that's expected. Okay, that's all I had in the PowerPoint. Also in the paper, I talk about carrier sense multiple access a little bit and the fact that the original defaults proposed for slot times for the preamble was 100 milliseconds, which strangely has become exceedingly slow. It's exceedingly too small. And so like the fact that the Kenwoods have a fixed 500 millisecond preamble is actually not at all out of line. I think in Appendix B, I went through the ARRL's hardware reviews for every mobile rig in the last 15 years, and I pulled out their receive to transmit and their transmit to receive changeover times, which if you add those two numbers together, need to be less than our preamble. Most of the radios, well, actually, all of the radios are well beyond 100 milliseconds. Not a single mobile rig reviewed in the last 15 years is fast enough to handle 100 milliseconds of preamble. None. Zero. Most of them are fast enough to handle 300, although one or two of them were actually so slow that they couldn't, in 300 milliseconds, key up the transmitter and open squelch on the other end, right? And this is the sort of stuff that we just need to start documenting, that the new defaults need to be decided upon, and we need to start actually writing specific documentation that doesn't only specify that, hey, this timer is important. I'm looking at you, AX25, because AX25 defines a ton of timers. They say they're really important and then give not even suggested defaults for their values, right? I hate to come here as the young whippersnapper and say, hey, you guys, you're killing me here. But as someone who grew up not using this technology, and I got apparently particularly spoiled reading RFCs, I'm looking at this stuff and I'm baffled by how little information I can find on it. So we need to start getting these quantitative documents written so that we can actually start building this stuff and have it all interoperate without me going on eBay, because I can't afford to pay $300 for one of these old TNCs, which you guys keep buying at you guys keep bidding up to these prices that I can't afford anymore. And so I don't have an ability to reverse engineer them. So this is kind of my call to arms that I didn't know about the Amateur Radio Engineering Task Force before this weekend, but please, 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 we need to start working on that sort of thing, because when I start on one of these projects, the first thing I do is I pull up the RFCs. And there's no RFCs for this stuff, and it's killing me. So So what I presented today is kind of the first of six subjects I really kind of focus on in my thesis. I'm hoping to get the rest of my thesis document somewhat finished and presented in sometime in the next quarter. And so I'll probably be making a lot of noise on the APRIS SIG once I get it published. And so in a few months, you can go back and find the other five chapters for it. But it pretty much all comes down to the fact that there's a lot of stuff, there's a lot of stuff that's either undefined or that is made no mention of that's exceedingly important that we just need to start making decisions on. And a lot of these decisions don't have right answers, but we just need to pick the one that's the least wrong, right? So 3.5 kilohertz flat deviation is, I'm not convinced that's technically correct, but I'm proposing that it's the least wrong answer in this situation. All right, is there any questions on this so far? All right, cool.
Okay, thank you, Kenneth. All right, so you're ready for the lightning talk? Okay, so keep rolling there, Gary. We're gonna sneak one in on you here. How many of you have been in the demo room and saw Kenneth's other demo where he's got voice over IP phones and he's got a PBX running and it's and there was no HSMM harmed in the making of it on that? Okay, how many of you would like to hear a little bit about it? Okay, so I asked Kenneth, and I want to thank Tom McDermott for the idea of a lightning talk. So I kind of did the ALS challenge to Kenneth to do a lightning talk. So he's got one slide here. So we're going to do a very quick, less than 5 minutes lightning talk on Kenneth's voice over IP mesh demo. Okay, take it away, Kenneth.
All right, hi, my name's Kenneth, and I'm going to be talking to you again. So as part of my hardware demo in there, which has nothing to do with my thesis, Last week, I was kind of sitting around, and I realized, hey, you know what I could do? I could put together a meshed voice over IP system between several telephones and a telephone exchange, which should be right there, but apparently there's a bug in LibreOffice that it doesn't do vector files correctly in presentation mode. So imagine that there's a box there that says SIP on it, right? And so I was just going to talk real quick about what I have going on. And again, I'm gonna slam into the HSMM guys because they've done a phenomenal job for enabling us to build meshes without knowing anything about it. They've done a phenomenal job at that. They've done such a good job that you can't find anything out about their systems. I've gone on HSMM and I've read every single shred of document that they've written and released, and I have no idea how their systems work. And I don't have the energy right now to install a couple of their nodes and start reverse engineering it because I'm getting tired of that. And so I went off last week and I wrote a couple shell scripts and I just built it myself, right? So what I've got is three WRT54Gs in there. Each one of them is running not HSMM's firmware, but a stock OpenWRT install. So I went to OpenWRT, installed the latest version of 10.4 that the WRTs supported. And then on each one of them, I have this shell script, which is available on GitHub, where I download it onto the router, I change the host name and the node number, I run it, it downloads, installs all the software I need for it, configures it, and that's it. All right? Unlike the HSMM guys, I think they're using network address translation. I'm actually using addresses in the amateur radio /8 block, which I haven't seen much of today, which is kind of disappointing. I was crushed when I saw David using 192.168 addresses, because we have this whole /16/44.128 that's used for these sort of experimental setups, right? And so on the actual mesh part, which is probably the most interesting, what I'm using is 802.11 ad hoc mode, right? And so unlike David's mode where he has a master access point and his stations connecting to it, in ad hoc mode, it's a completely peer-to-peer connection so that if one of these nodes gets hidden from another node, so if this link were to break, regardless of, they can both talk to this node, even though one of them may seem more important than the others. All right, and so the single point-to-point links are relatively easy to set up. What gets difficult is if this link right here gets segregated, how does this node talk to this node? And that's solved using what's called OLSR, Optimized Link State Routing. OLSR is a routing protocol that I believe the HSMM guys use this. Where each one of the nodes broadcasts on its Wi-Fi saying, hello, this is my IP address. These are the people that I can get you to next. And here are the subnets that I am also connected to. Right? So if you look back at this diagram, each one of these nodes broadcasts not only their own IP address, but also the subnet that's hanging off of them, which includes the telephones. Right? And so this is kind of the basic how the meshed clients should be talking to each other. And so when this phone needs to talk to the SIP exchange, which is here, all it knows about is that its gateway is here. This router has heard from this router, hey, this is my IP address. I'm connected to this subnet. So if this SIP server were a fixed IP address on the subnet, this phone would say, I need to get to the SIP server. This router would say, all right, it needs to go through there, and then this one would be directly connected to it. I went a step further, and I actually ran the same meshing routing that's up here on the Ethernet interfaces. Right? So in addition to any standard client that gets plugged in using DHCP to get an address, I'm using OLSR to route to this invisible SIP server, because, you know, vector files. And so the router here is a fixed IP address. The server here is a fixed IP address. So when I pull this out of the box, out of my duffel bag, I could have plugged the server into any router I wanted because it's all meshed together, right? As far as on the technology side, as far as Asterisk, I'm running what's called Asterisk here, which, as David said, is a fantastic piece of voice over IP software that you want to get in your to-do list as far as what to learn. And so each one of these SIP phones, which I get for about $14 a piece on surplus, they register themselves with the SIP server, all right, saying, all right, here's my username, and here is my IP address. On the SIP server, I then wrote what's called a dial plan, where I said, all right, if any phone dials an extension 203, tell them to go talk to this phone number, you know, called SIP-ZIP-3, right? The dial plan in Asterisk is phenomenally flexible in that you don't have to map single extensions to single phones. You can map a ring every phone extension. And so if you wanted to have an extension that rings every single phone in the network, you can do it. If you wanted to, like in my demo, I actually have a conference call set up. So if you dial HAM or 426, it will put you into a conference room where you can have as many of these telephones talking to each other as you like. Let's see, what was the other thing? I haven't well documented the actual SIP server yet on the GitHub, but that's gonna be coming. And I'm gonna start doing all sorts of blog posts on my personal website, blog.thelifeofkenneth.com. But since this all happened last week, I haven't actually written it up yet. Other than that, I guess I'm gonna trash on the WRT54Gs a little bit here. They're starting to show their age, right? We've been playing with these things for 12 years now, and they are really starting to show their age. They're only 802.11g, which, I mean, saying that something's only 54 megabits right after I gave a presentation on 1200 baud is a little ironic. So I'm gonna play both sides of the card here, but they're only 802.11g, they're not MIMO. They have two antennas because they've got an antenna switch in them. So it's received diversity. There's only one transceiver in them. These things are, they have jitter like crazy, right? So the fact that the demo I have in there working right now is only because these WRTs are 2 feet away from each other. I set up a 2 kilometer link with WRTs, and I was seeing latency on an unloaded link jumping between 20 milliseconds and 200 milliseconds, which is a little annoying for voice over IP stuff. So the fact that I've got that demo working in there is a little deceptive. And I would encourage, if any of you want to unplug one of those nodes and walk around the hotel with it and see how it fails, by all means. The Linksys WRTs are really, they're starting to show their age, which is kind of nice because you can pick them up in lots of like 15 or 20 on eBay now. But they're not really the right tool for what we're trying to do for a lot of this stuff. So I've done a lot of deployments with the Ubiquiti stuff, like David showed, and that stuff's much better. The Linksys stuff are decent routers on the near end, but they weren't made for the long distance point-to-point links that we've been trying to get them to do, right? So there's a lot of problems in the actual Wi-Fi part. And they're a little annoyingly small in the fact that they only have 4 megabytes of flash, but they're decent, very low-end routers. So they have their applications, but that's about it, all right? So other than that, by all means, I'll be in there. You can wave me down later if you have any specific
all
questions
right, very,
on this.
Very quick questions.
All right.
I just want to point out to HSMM and everyone who works on this, that OpenWRT supports at least 100 different routers.
Yes.
And that it just makes zero sense to be working on this old hardware.
Yes. And that's kind of the difference. This shell script should run on pretty much any device and just work, right? So if you have anything that supports OpenWRT, that shell script should just run on it and you'll have a mesh node. You'll have to do a few tweaks on it based on the exact interfaces. But binding ourselves to things as WRT54G, and then finally they're coming out with a Ubiquiti firmware image. I was unimpressed by that, right? If this is a mesh between an arbitrary number of nodes, we should make the nodes arbitrary. So.
Okay, one last question. Thank you for the talk. A problem with these amateur radio protocols is the fact that you can't use encryption. So how do you handle the routing securely? Because anybody could send advertisements.
Ah, yes. So Bruce Perrins and I have been butting heads on this for a long time. I finally have come to the conclusion that the way around Part 97 for these sort of mesh networks is to not use Part 97. Right? I hate to say it, but Part 15 gets you a really long way. I've done 6, 7, 8 kilometer links with Part 15, and then I'm free to use any encryption and any SSH protocol, and it's just not feasible to try and get to get an IP link to be Part 97 link legal. So I won't discourage anyone from trying, but until Part 97 gets sufficiently rewritten, screw it, I'm just gonna do Part 15.
And there you have it.